Yes, he's a sports legend, one of the greatest basketball players ever, maybe the greatest, but that's so yesterday. For years now, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar has been a best-selling author, activist, and social commentator. And along with all those championship and MVP trophies, a couple of months back, he received the Presidential Medal of Freedom. His latest book, Writings on the Wall, goes deep into the divisions in American society. Sound timely? Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and his co-author, Raymond Obstfeld, are here in studio right now on Inside OC. Inside OC is brought to you by 5 Point. 5 Point is an independent real estate development company with assets under management across California. 5 Point is a proud sponsor of public television and community programming.
Memorial Care is transforming the way healthcare is delivered, keeping our communities and businesses healthy by guiding them on the path to wellness with easily accessible hospitals, physician offices, and outpatient centers. Memorial Care, leading the way.
Hi, I'm Rick Reiff, and I'm talking with Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and Raymond Obstfeld. And as you can see, Kareem, we have a studio audience here to cheer you on. You're kind of used to crowds and fans, right? That's
for the most part, yeah.
Okay. So anyway, let's talk. I just referenced at the top, you just recently won the Congressional Medal of Freedom. I believe it was back in November. President Obama, just after the election, had you at the White House. You've won so many honors, received so many things. How did this one feel?
It felt great because it had nothing to do really with my sports career. It had to do with the things I've done away from the game and, my activism and writing. So I felt good that it would be viewed in that light and I would get an award like that. It was very prestigious to me.
Met the president before?
I met him several times. I met him when he was a senator.
Oh, really? From Illinois?
Yeah.
Really? Now, how did that come about?
I was in the Senate building, and we were there to speak to Senator Cole from Wisconsin. He was involved with the Milwaukee Bucks. I played for them and everything.
Right.
And he said, "Is there anybody here you wanted to meet?" Geez, I'd like to meet Obama. He's from Illinois, and Illinois and Wisconsin share a border. They knew each other, so he took me by Mr. Obama's office,
wow.
And I met him then.
Yeah, did you ever think at that point, I think this guy's going to be president someday?
No, I didn't. But I thought that he had really good ideas, and he was really a fresh voice in the Democratic Party. It wasn't the same old stuff. It was a new approach and trying to modernize things. I thought he had some promise, but you know how that is.
There's
promise around every corner here in America,
Yeah. So how, this was just after the election and you're meeting him and he knows you. Did you get a sense that there was a little disappointment about things or, did you have a chance to talk to him at all about that?
No, I didn't have a chance to talk to him about it. But, the Democrats lost because they didn't have a focused message. They were all over the place. And, Trump understood the votes that he wanted to get, and he guessed right. He picked the right group of people to go after that swung the election. So that you have to give them credit for their foresight and their determination. And that's why they won it.
That sounds almost conciliatory on your part in a way.
I think it's realistic. I don't feel very conciliatory toward them. I don't like the way that they're governing, but they won it. They knew what they were doing, and the Democrats didn't know what they were doing.
Right. And so you talk about Trump having some good timing. You did too, because this book, which we are now going to get into, Writings on the Wall. The flyleaf says it's about how the America of today is a fractured society sharply divided along lines of race, gender, religion, political party, and economic class. When you wrote it, it was still during the election and during the campaign, and you made some references to Trump in this.
Oh, yeah.
But
yeah.
Did... I mean, it's really timely now, given what's happened.
Yeah, look at what's happened since the election. You know, it's gotten worse.
Yeah, yeah. So Raymond, let's bring you in on this. You are the co-author of this book, and you've got to tell us. You are a creative writing professor at Orange Coast College.
Right.
So how did you hook up with Kareem and wind up as a co-author, not just on this, but on several other books?
Oh, it was years ago. I don't remember how many. Seven, maybe. Do you remember?
It's getting to be a long time now.
Yeah. Well, don't say it that way.
Success, you know. Jeez. We like success. You know?
I think we're breaking up. I don't know. No, about 7 years ago, his manager, Deborah Morales, had asked me if we could meet and talk about a project that was very close to him, which was about the Harlem Renaissance, because the great influence it had on Kareem. And we actually were talking about doing a documentary, and I suggested maybe we should do a book about it first. And so we did. That's how we started writing about the Harlem Renaissance, and that book was well received, and then we worked together so well, I think, and so seamlessly that we just kept doing it.
So Kareem, now that we mentioned the Harlem Renaissance, what is the Harlem Renaissance?
The Harlem Renaissance basically describes the cultural impact of Black Americans that they had on American culture between 1910, basically, and 1950, when they got the idea that maybe it wasn't too good to be in the South and they needed to get out of there. So they got out of the South, and Black culture just blossomed. The 1920s is still known as the jazz era for that reason. But Black culture influenced American culture in a lot of different ways, music especially, but also a lot of the cultural aspects, you know, poetry, the different writings and political activism, where Black Americans started to understand that they needed to unify and organize in order to get their political and civil rights.
Yeah.
You know, that had to be a focus. And so that time of coming together and having their voices heard, that's known as the Harlem Renaissance.
How did you kind of find out or learn about the Harlem Renaissance, and what impact has it had on you?
I learned about it the summer between my junior and senior years in high school. I was involved in a program in Harlem that was started by a sociologist, and it was designed to get the kids in Harlem to figure out how to make it a better place. So they gave us a salary and told us that geez, what would you like to do? I got involved in a journalism workshop because I wanted to write. So we had to write a weekly newspaper about our community. So I had to find out why Harlem was such an important place for Black Americans. The fact that people like Duke Ellington and Josephine Baker and Louis Armstrong were all discovered while they were in Harlem. They weren't from Harlem, but Harlem being a focus of Black American life, these people got discovered, and they went from there around the world. Duke Ellington ended up in Paris entertaining the Europeans. Jazz music became a very popular thing worldwide, and people started to recognize Black Americans as more than just people who pick cotton. You know, you had Paul Robeson and other artists and authors that really changed people's ideas about what Black America was all about.
And all of this happened at a time of great discrimination.
Oh yeah, it was the Jim Crow era, you know, which was right after the Reconstruction, where the people who lost the Civil War wanted to take out their frustration on their victims, you know, on the people who had been slaves, on that segment of society. It was a very sad time, because here you have people, because they felt so bad about losing the Civil War, they gave into their worst impulses, and they oppressed and really made life miserable for Black Americans. Yeah. And Black Americans finally got the idea, maybe we better get out of the South. And that's what changed the culture of the United States for Americans of African descent.
So Raymond, in collaborating on a story about Harlem, collaborating on writings on the wall. How did the two of you divide your duties? Kind of like, what do you do and what does Kareem do?
It's such a ebb and flow of stuff that we do together. He'll sketch out something and then show it to me, and then I'll fill in some stuff and I'll show it to him, and then he'll fill in some stuff and show it to me, and we talk on the phone a lot, and so it's really just, you know, each one getting more. If he writes something, and I'll ask him some more questions about it, and then I'll write something, and he'll say, yeah, but we should do this, and it's just really very seamless. And
so, kind of like basketball to me, that we pass the ball back and forth, you know, and sometimes he takes a shot, and sometimes I'm open.
Do you ever call him magic?
No.
But you should.
I think I've called him Watson once or twice. Right? But the ability that, you know, we can communicate like that, and, you know, not, you know, sometimes I don't like one of his ideas, he doesn't get beat up about it. Sometimes I say something that's totally off the wall. I don't get beat up about it. And, you know, being able to go back and forth like that without getting hurt, that's a key.
You know? All right. Well, let me make a jump ball here, and either one of you can take it. The title, Writings on the Wall, I thought was kind of interesting. When I hear that, I think of that biblical story about and the king who the writing was for. Things didn't turn out well for him. It's kind of an ill omen. Is this book a warning or an ill omen?
Well, it also has reference to pop culture, because Stevie Wonder, his song Superstition, Writings on the Wall, when you believe in things that you don't understand, you suffer. So a lot of people relate to Stevie Wonder. He's got all those Grammy Awards in his house. So, you know, that connects with people on a lot of different levels in that sense.
Yeah, so let's talk about some of the things. You cover everything in this book. I mean, so we could pick out almost any topic that's a current timely topic. It's in the book. But one thing that, of course, is very personal with you is the Islamic faith, and you talk about that. And you have had a journey yourself within the Muslim faith. So what's it like today to be a Muslim in America?
Well, it's hard times. You know, I was so used to being under the radar. People didn't know that much about Islam. It wasn't a problem. They were more or less content to let it go on that way. And then after 9/11, it changed dramatically. And it's now up to Muslims to go out and let people know what Islam is about and what it isn't about. Because these people, you know, these ISIS people, they're barbarians. They are about insanity and just the worst that you can think of, fascism and barbarism all combined in a modern context. They're horrible people, and they claim to represent Islam, and they don't. But, you know, Muslims have to define that. So, you know, we have a job to do in that sense.
Yeah, and how do you respond to, you know, people who say that Islam is, you know, there are violent strains in Islam, and, you know, that sort of thing?
There are violent strains in any religious group. You have violent Jewish settlers in the West Bank. You have the IRA. You have other groups that are using religion as an excuse to commit murder. This is insanity. This is not what any of these religions talk about. But it's very easy and convenient to use stereotypes like that. But the thing that bothers me the most is that the majority of the people that ISIS has killed have been Muslims. They are an oppressive, fascist group, and they need to be destroyed. And I don't think any practicing Muslim would disagree with that statement.
If you were to give some words of advice to your non-Muslim friends as to something they should think about, and on the other side, one of your Muslim friends, something they should think about, what would it be?
Well, for my Muslim friends, I would tell them that they have to let people understand what Islam is about. And now all that takes is starting a conversation. And that's very hard for some people, you know, just to say, hello, this is who I am, this is what I'm about. Mm-hmm. But this is how these things are settled. And when people get an idea of what it's about, that changes. You know, there's so many stories now. I just read a story in today's New York Times where a number of towns in upstate New York have welcomed the refugees because they brought in people that have replenished the population supply and made it possible for these towns to thrive again.
Yeah.
You know, because they lost so many of the young people have left town. So, you know, all of this stuff about all of the refugees being a negative influence in America. America has always thrived on immigrants.
Yeah, so Raymond, I'm sure the two of you talk about these things when you're writing the book. What do you have any thoughts on this topic?
Yeah, we have a very similar background. I was raised Jewish in a small town in Pennsylvania where my parents had a Jewish delicatessen with a huge Star of David on it, which was like a Target. And it was a Target. Our store got shot. We had bullet holes through it. It eventually got firebombed. And that was pretty much how I was raised. And he has a similar background. So we come from that same background of oppression. I was in a small town when we didn't have much of a black population, so the Jews took the brunt of it all. But I think when we're talking about this a little bit, I think about that guy that was just caught who was planning to bomb 10 targets on the coast, if you followed that story. And I really think that has a lot to do with it's the and all he wanted to do was bring down targets' prices so he could buy stock lower. But I think that's the essence of a lot of terrorism, which is it's economic. It's not about the religion. The religion is how you manipulate people. When you get to the core of people's belief, which is what that book is really about, which is showing that people want to do the right thing. And that book is about trying to find out people, helping people just be good and do the right thing. And I think that's what we agree on. And that's the heart of what we try to do together.
And we will get back to this book, but I do want to talk about what's next. Because as I understand it, first, you have another book coming out. And even before that, Kareem, you've got a book coming out on Coach Wooden.
Yes, it's called Coach Wooden and Me. It's about my 50-year relationship with Coach Wooden. And just how it evolved and what it was all about. He's an incredible person in my life, just in the influence that he had on me that I wasn't aware of. You know, when you sit at the foot of a master and learn things, you get things that you're not aware of. But you know, as I was raising my kids and stuff, I would remember things that I'd gone through at basketball practice, and I was doing the same thing with my kids, you know, just to challenge them, and they would challenge me back and show me how they were going to do it. And then when they failed, that's when I got a chance to have that teaching moment. But I learned that technique from Coach. That's part of how he taught us.
I can't wait for that book because it had to have been a very interesting relationship, especially when you were playing at UCLA. You were going through a lot. Yeah. I mean, you were going through religious changes. You were getting involved in the civil rights movement. You were doing a lot of things. And wasn't John Wooden kind? I thought he was sort of an old school guy.
He was, but you know, he never interfered. He never felt that it was his place to interfere and tell us what to do. But he would challenge us in as far as like, well, what's this about, and why are you doing it, and you know, just to see what our purpose was. And you know, if we had it together up here as to what we were doing, we weren't going off half-cocked. So he would talk to us about it, but he never told us do this or don't do that. He just wanted to know what our thought process was and you know, what our goals were.
And and then after you, he had Bill Walton. So another handful.
Yeah.
Oh, you weren't a challenge. Yeah.
I went along with the program, but Bill had other ideas. You know? So and he expressed them. But, you know, he came about, the Vietnam thing was coming to an absolute crisis point, you know, while he was going to UCLA. Yeah. So that really got to Bill, and he wanted to be involved. And, you know, Bill's parents were like socialist kind of people from the 30s, you know, Woody Guthrie, those kind of people.
Yeah,
yeah, they and so Bill was raised in a activist environment. So I wasn't surprised about that.
So you know, I just to go back to Coach Wooden, though, were there people saying, don't listen to that guy. What does he know? He's out of it or whatever.
As I got to know Coach Wooden, I knew he wasn't out of it. He had an extraordinary life and had done things. I found out things that he had done just in the last 10 years that blew my mind. Coach Wooden had done activist things for civil rights causes back in the 1940s. Nobody knew about it. He had a player on his team when he was coaching in Indiana. He had one black player on his team. And his team did so well, they were invited to the college tournament at that time. It's called the NAIA, National Association of Intercollegiate Athletics. And then that was the big tournament at the end of the season. So they invited Coach Wooden's team. And they said, you know, you guys had a great season. Why don't you come to the tournament? We've written you in. You got picked and seated. He said, great. And they said, one thing, though, you can't bring your black player. So Coach Wooden said, you know, we played this whole season as a team. We're going to end the season as a team. We can't come if we can't bring our whole team. And they said, you got to reconsider, Coach. Coach said, no, that's it. They didn't go. The next season comes along. His team does even better. He gets the same call. They have the same conversation. Coach Wooden said, well, you know, we can't come. So they said, Coach, you got to come. They said, well, if I can't bring my whole team, we're not coming. So they conceded that issue. And that player was the very first player to compete in the NAIA, first black American to compete in the NAIA tournament.
And you learned this many years later.
Like just a couple of years before Coach Wooden died. And he never mentioned it. You know, here I am, an activist, Dr. King, following, you know, all of this, Malcolm X, all of these issues and events having to do with black Americans, and Coach Wooden had been involved some 30 years prior and never said a word about it.
Is that because he was a modest guy? Or?
Yeah, and he said, I just did the right thing when I was supposed to do it. And he didn't want to take any more credit.
Wow. Yeah, one of the important things about that is that black player wasn't even a starter.
Right.
He was just more bench.
He's a bench player.
It didn't matter. He was going to take him no matter what.
Wow. So Raymond, tell us about the new book that the two of you are collaborating on.
Well, we're doing a book called Becoming Kareem. And it's really about Kareem's youth from elementary school through changing his name, converting to Islam and then changing his name. So the whole process of becoming the person he is now, basically, and what that all meant to him and the steps along the way that... And a lot of it has to do with the various people in his life, we basically call them coaches, that along the way that influenced him to become that person.
Wow. Another iconic sports figure who's been very visible lately, Jim Brown, the great running back. And I know you have shared podiums with him, and I assume you know him pretty well. He seems to be taking a much different tack than most critics of Donald Trump. Let's put it that way. He's saying he's meeting with him. He's giving him a chance. How do you feel about that his position?
Well, I spoke to Jim, and he said, look, the man is in power. He runs our country. We need to have access to power, even if that person is not sympathetic to our positions. We still have to deal with this person. So, you know, that's a very common sense approach. I'm not on Jim's case about it. I don't know how much he's going to be able to achieve. Trump is all over the place. I don't think he listens to anybody, so that's my opinion on it. But I don't think Jim has like become senile or stupid in his old age. He just took a different course.
How do you feel about folks? I think Jim might, and I think Jim Brown has said he voted for Hillary Clinton, but that in a way, Trump. Remember, he gave that a number of times. He said to black voters, "What have you got to lose? You know, what has the current system done for you? Why not give me a chance?"
Well, he's not going to do anything for black Americans. I mean, he just said that to address that issue. Uh-huh. And if you remember the context in which he made those statements, it was in front of an all-white audience. He wouldn't meet with the Black caucus. He's you know, he picks his times. He met at a Black church with some people that had were totally in his pocket. I wouldn't attribute much significance to those meetings.
So you're cautiously not optimistic?
I'm not optimistic at all. He hasn't impressed me, I'll tell you that.
Okay. So that's it for this show, but our discussion will continue, and you can watch that next time. For now, thanks to my guests, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar and Raymond Obstfeld. You can watch this show and past shows by going to pbssoulcal.org or rickreiff.com. You can also catch our shows and our post-show open mic chatter on YouTube. And follow us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. Thanks for watching. We'll see you again on Inside OC. Inside OC is brought to you by Five Point. Five Point is an independent real estate development company with assets under management across California. Five Point is a proud sponsor of public television and community programming.
Chapman University, with its Center for Science and Technology, under construction in Orange, California, is a proud sponsor of Inside OC.